because the city of Rome is founded on the saints who are martyrs, apostles and martyrs, because in this month we have the celebration at the end of June on the 29th. So we are here to celebrate together this victory that is not a victory of which was achieved with weapons or a political dominance or prevailing according to the criteria of the world. We are rather here to celebrate this victory that is the only victory that Christians feel they can really celebrate, and it's the victory of faith. So this is the victory of the world, our faith. These are the words of the Apostle St. John in his first letter. For the community of Sant'Egidio and for all of us, this conference is something that we need to have because of memory. It's an apostolic church that is rooted in the Middle East. It's a church that brought, together with other testimonies of the witnesses of the Christian faith, it brought the Christian faith to the West. So it is something that we really owe because of memory. It's a debt of memory, but it's also a gift that Sant'Egidio feels to the need to give to the Syriac church and to Patriarch Ephraim because of the friendship we have with this church and a special friendship with the Patriarch Ephraim. So we are here and we are celebrating 1 year from the first day. So 1 year and some days. But we are in a big family, so we were waiting to have you here in Rome in order to give you a hand. And before leaving you the floor, please allow me to say, among the many things you might say about him and about his long-standing friendship, if the Patriarch allows me, it's a friendship of disciples with Mar Joanna Gregorius Ibrahim. That we would like to remember. And a few moments ago, we have been praying for him in the Cathedral of St. Mary in Trastevere with the Patriarch and with the delegation of bishops and metropolitans that I would like to extend my greetings to. And they came with the Patriarch to visit the Holy Father, the Bishop of Rome, the city of Rome, and the Sant'Egidio community. So by reminding Gregorius together with him, I would like to remember all those who were abducted and who are suffering in these hours in Syria, Bishop of Poliasici, Bishop Kayak, Mafus, Paolo Dall'Oglio. This gift of Sant'Egidio is also a gift of memory, prayer, and friendship to the Syriac Church and Christians in the Middle East and Patriarch Ephraim. And I'm really pleased to leave him the floor. Right now.
Thank you so much, Vittorio. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm indeed very pleased to be with you following a very historical and beneficial meeting with His Holiness the Pope. It's my pleasure now to be with the Sant'Egidio community that's very dear to us and near to us. And it's even closer to us through the absence of our sin. We have become even closer because of the absence of His Eminence Mar Gregorius Johanna Ibrahim and His Eminence Bulus Sirazigi, for whom we pray every day with the community that they may come to us back safe. And I'm very happy to have among us this afternoon His Beatitude, Mar Ignatius Yusuf Yunan, the Patriarch of Antioch for the Syrian Catholic, a dear friend and brother in Christ. Your Beatitude, Eminences, Professor Riccardi, Your Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Allow us first to thank Sant'Egidio community for organizing this conference on the Syriac genocide, Seyfo. We would like to thank especially Professor Andrea Riccardi for taking interest in the issue of Seyfo and for publishing a new book on the subject of the massacres and atrocities committed during the genocide. Since the 1990s, the Syriac institutions and organizations in Europe started advocating for the recognition of the Syriac genocide alongside the Armenian genocide by the governments of European countries. However, we can say that the Syriac Orthodox Church officially started promoting this cause only a year ago, namely after our Holy Synod took the decision to commemorate the centennial of Seyfo. What are we commemorating in Seyfo? Unfortunately, we do not have enough information in order to give an accurate account of what happened during Seyfo. Very few eyewitness accounts survived. Nevertheless, a campaign to document the personal stories of some survivors of the genocide during the last two decades was carried out mainly in Europe. These stories give us some valuable information concerning the horrific acts of violence committed against our people during the years of Seyfo. Estimates vary as to how many of our people perished as a result of Seyfo, but most scholars and researchers put the number above 500,000 of Syriac-speaking martyrs. That includes members of the sister churches, the Syrian Church of the East, Chaldean Church, Syriac Catholic, and Syrian Orthodox Churches. More than 500,000 were put to death, among them bishops, monks, and priests. What took place can be rightfully described as a religio-ethnic cleansing inspired by the pan-Turkic ideologies of the Young Turks, who looked at the non-Turkic people among them, such as the Armenians, Greeks, and Syriacs, as a threat to their unity. Seyfo left a deep impact in the life of our church. Indeed, more than two-thirds of the Syriac population was exterminated, and our church lost many dioceses, churches, monasteries, and a large part of its heritage. In short, this is what we are commemorating: events of profound meaning and lasting consequences which changed the course of our life as a community forever. Why are we commemorating Seyfo? Seyfo opened a wound in our hearts that was never healed. For a long time, we as a community did not talk about it. For some of us, the memories were too painful to share, and for others, there was always fear about the safety of those of us who remain in the homeland. We need to commemorate Seyfo in order to step into the path of healing, justice, and reconciliation. By commemorating the dreadful events of 1915, we wish to start the healing process of the wounds of the past. In addition, we owe it to our martyrs to speak about what happened. This would restore, though in part, some of the justice that is not done. Moreover, commemorating Seyfo, we hope, will open the way for meaningful reconciliation between the descendants of the perpetrators and those of the victims. Reconciliation is a necessary step in order to establish permanent peace and good relationships between the peoples of the region where it all happened. Most importantly, we are commemorating the centennial of the Seyfo to remind the world how humans behaved once and to expose what the consequences of extremism and fanaticism can be. We do so in the hope that such a genocide is not repeated and such violence is never witnessed again. Indeed, today more than ever, we can see how religious extremism leads to conflicts and destruction. What is happening in Iraq and Syria is a good example. What Christians are experiencing in the Middle East is nothing short of a new genocide. expulsion of Christians from their houses, expiation, violence, and killing are some of what we are facing on a daily basis. We have visited northern Iraq for four times within the last 6 months of 2014. In order to be with our people who were forced to flee from Mosul to the villages of the Nineveh Plain, and then again from the Nineveh Plain to safer parts of Iraqi Kurdistan. We have observed the efforts of the local churches as well as the international organizations to ease the magnitude of the crisis, to enable the refugees to survive the coldest nights and to provide them with food, clothes, and health care. To this present day, Christians in northern Iraq did not return to their homes or villages. On Tuesday, last Tuesday, just one day before we left Damascus, a missile hit the old part of Damascus, close to the eastern gate, Bab Sharqi, halfway between the place where St. Paul was baptized and where he was let down in a basket, causing many casualties, fear, and uncertainty among the people. We risk our lives on a daily basis because of terrorism and fanaticism. In consequence, people who live in the country are struggling financially and live by what charity organizations offer them to survive. Thousands, Christians and Muslims alike, Muslims more than Christians, come to our patriarchate seeking help and support to survive the calamities and recover their loss. They seek help to find jobs, pay rent, have medical exams and surgical operations, food parcels, baby formulas, etc. The church is practicing her mission to fulfill to the fullest with these children of God. The main problem that we are facing is migration. Now, Syrians in general and Christians in particular seek refuge outside Syria, looking for security and peace, and escaping from the risk of abduction and death. Indeed, the abduction of the two archbishops of Aleppo, the dear friend of this community, our beloved brother, Mor Gregorius Yohanna Ibrahim, and Metropolitan Boulos Yazici, is an action that led Christians to flee the country. About 26 months have passed since their abduction, yet we have no solid information concerning their whereabouts or their kidnappers, and no demands were ever made to have them back. Likewise, Father Jack Murad, a Syriac Catholic priest, together with a layperson, were abducted from the church parish house in Al Qaryatayn, not far from Homs, over a month ago, and so far no information is available about them. How are we commemorating Seyfo? We inaugurated the year of the centennial of Seyfo with a divine liturgy celebrated at our patriarchal headquarters in Damascus and another divine liturgy in Beirut. We have also opened an exhibition on the massacres and atrocities of Seyfo. Our Holy Synod, which convened last week, decided to adopt June 15 as an annual date for commemorating the Syriac genocide Seyfo. Having studied several dates, this we found to be more suitable for us because of events that happened at the beginning of June. We are pleased also to know that His Beatitude, our dear brother in Christ Patriarch Mor Ignatius Yusuf Yunan, has also declared that the Syriac Catholic Church will observe the same day in commemoration of the Syriac genocide, Seyfo. Last weekend, at the conclusion of our Holy Synod, with the participation of our brother patriarchs of Antioch, we consecrated an altar in the name of the Syriac martyrs of Seyfo in our Morafrem monastery in Mar Sayidnaya. We likewise consecrated the Holy Mirun, Holy Chrism, on the occasion of the centennial of Seyfo. In addition, we inaugurated a monument in the same monastery and another one at our patriarchate in Damascus. And a third monument was also inaugurated in the newly named Syriac Martyrs Garden, a garden which is owned by the city of Damascus. Similarly, many commemorating services for Seyfo were organized and many monuments for Seyfo were inaugurated during our apostolic visits to our dioceses in Europe. So far, two books have been published by our patriarchate on Seyfo, The massacres of Tur Abdin by the late Father Suleiman Hanno, translated from Syriac into English, and Sebastian de Courtois' The Forgotten Genocide, translated into Arabic. And we hope Professor Riccardi's book also will be soon translated. We are preparing for an orchestral symphony in the Opera House of Damascus, specially composed for the occasion. Likewise, we are organizing a conference at the University of the Holy Spirit in Kaslik, Lebanon, jointly with our sister Syriac Catholic Patriarchate. Finally, for the first time, we displayed the relics of some martyrs of Seyfo last Saturday in Syria. And we bring with us some relics of the same martyrs also to be displayed in St. Bartholomew Church, the Church of the New Martyrs in Rome, and remain a blessing for those who visit. Brothers and sisters, once again, we thank all the scholars who are participating in this conference and all those who are researching and promoting Seyfo in different parts of the world. Your work and research helps us keep the memory alive. We would like to thank the community of Sant'Egidio and all those who prepared for this conference. Thank you so much, and may God bless you all.
Thank you, Holiness, for these words which introduce us to the topic we'll be discussing this afternoon and tomorrow morning. And I'm very pleased to hear that in the things you said, you expressed your joy for the presence of His Beatitude Patriarch Yunnan, who represents, through his person and through his apostolic activities, the other component of the Syriac community, which gathers to commemorate Seyfo. As the Patriarch was saying, and I was quite struck by what he said, it was a memory which people felt ashamed of. There was it was embarrassing to remember it. How many massacres, not only among the Christians, were not spoken of due to shame, difficulties, fatigue, fear? And this memory is so important. It's a memory which reaches out to reconciliation. It's a memory which wants to heal these deep wounds. And that's also something he mentioned with a great deal of understanding. We heard of all the initiatives which are introducing a new season, so to speak, in which the memory of Seyfo will contribute to the strengthening of the Christian and apostolic testimony of the Syriac Church in all of its various manifestations. I'd like to give the floor to Professor Andrea Riccardi, who, as many of you know, besides being a well-known church historian, has also recently published a book dedicated to this very topic, The Forgotten Massacre. And I want to welcome all those from Mardin, all those coming from Mardin, who, in Professor Riccardi's book, were able to find a significant memory, a significant trace, based on the spirit and the sentiments that the Patriarch was mentioning. We must remember to build a bridge between those who suffered towards those who offended, because only by building bridges can we build the future. You have the floor, Professor Riccardi. Thank you. Thank you very much indeed. I want to thank His Holiness and his delegation for his very kind words. I also want to greet Cardinal Casper, who is here among us, who is a dear friend, who whose home is here in Sant'Egidio, and who is at home with the Syriacs, Patriarch Yunnan, who is here too. We are here to remember the massacre which took place 100 years ago, especially in the most forgotten corner of this history, Seyfo, the slaughter of the Syrians, both Orthodoxes and Catholics, the Chaldeans and the Assyrians. It's no detail. It's a historical truth which does make the difference. Because by studying Seyfo, we can understand that in 1915 and the following years, we didn't simply have the slaughter of the Armenians. It was a slaughter of the Christians. There was a misunderstanding in the beginning, which led to forgetting other Christians. And it was quite comfortable, because the slaughter was reduced to a mere national event, a mere national fact. And following the First World War, Elias III, the Syrian Patriarch, wrote to the Archbishop of Canterbury, and the Anglican Church was one of the few international relations that the Syrian Patriarchy had. And he wrote, "All Christians had the same painful fate. It isn't a matter of competition between victims. It would be an absurdity." And as a matter of fact, the Syrians had a nearly forgotten church by other Christians. It was a poor church, one which was faithful and loyal to a rich spiritual tradition in an agricultural world, next to its monasteries, as in the Tourbeen. And historian Fernand Braudel refers to these lands as a place of protection. The Maronites on Mount Lebanon and the Valdese in the mountains of the Alps. The Syrian and Assyrian issue was not a problem following World War I. The Armenian issue was discussed in the peace conference because the Armenian events had become a major national issue, such as the ones in the 1800s in Greece and in Italy. This was linked to the nationalities also of the Habsburg nationalities, but this didn't happen for the other Christians. And these Christians, though, had to experience the slaughters, cruelty, marches of death, families being separated, the expropriation of their belongings, the destruction of their churches, forced conversion, kidnappings of children and of young women. His Holiness was right when he said that for them, they were faced with a huge silence. It wasn't only the silence of denial of the Turkish Republic, which is a fact, which was the outcome of an ideology, but it was also the outcome of a fact that a part of the ruling class of Ataturk's Republic was made up by young Turks, those who had perpetrated the massacre. But there was also silence on the part of the churches. It was forbidden to speak because a part of Christians continued to live on Turkish territory. And these Christians were defined with a vulgar Turkish expression. They were described as the remains of the sword. In 1986, I began to meet them in Tourbeen and in Mardin. And only during intimacy did they actually refer to those tragic events which they had kept in their families' memories. Everything else was silence. And yet, those who experienced the tragic events of 1915 and the following years had the feeling that the events which had taken place went beyond any human measure. It went beyond any human understanding. It was too much. Too much, even compared to the waves of violence that Christian minorities had been accustomed to in the Middle East. It was something unthinkable. That's why many witnesses to these events wrote about them. As Professor Ternan knows, only in the case of Mardin, many, in fact, wrote down their memories of those events on paper, both the local population and the French. But for decades, their writings remained buried in archives. No one was interested in them. Silence once again. And Father Retore's memories, a French Dominican who was who wrote the most effective things on the events which happened in Mardin and in the region, was only published in the year 2000 by Marco Pagliazzo, in the year 2000, many decades after those events. And Yves Ternon, who is a scholar of these issues, underscores how specific this event was and how silence happened for over 80 years. The martyrs were without memory. There were no processes of beatification. Only John Paul II in 2001 beatified the first martyr, the Armenian Catholic Archbishop of Mardin, Maloyan, who was a prominent figure in Catholic Christianity, made up of the Armenian Catholics, the Syrian Catholics, and the Chaldeans. And in the same year, in 2001, when John Paul II spoke of the Armenian genocide, but only of the Armenian genocide. For John Paul II, it wasn't a political issue. It was the recognition of the martyrdom of the Christians as the duty of a mother towards her fallen children. It wasn't a political issue. John Paul II wanted the Basilica of St. Bartholomew, entrusted to the community of Sant'Egidio, would become a memorial for the new martyrs, because the martyrs had to be remembered. And John Paul II stated that in martyrdom, Christians are already united. Modestly speaking, the passion with which Sant'Egidio organized this conference has a 30 to 40 year history. I remember very well one day in Damascus in 1985, in the Patriarchate, when the unforgettable Patriarch Zaka welcomed me, together with Monsignor Paglia and Claudio Betti, together with Mar Gregorius of Aleppo. And in the Patriarchate, Patriarch Zaka showed me a painting illustrating the monastery of Deir al-Zafaran. And he said, sadly, that's where we come from, but almost nothing is left of us. And I felt a deep desire to get to know those places. And in 1986, a pilgrimage Sant'Egidio organized with over 100 participants visited those places, and we felt very much aware of a feeling of an end. Following that trip, there was the event of a large number of Iraqi Christians who left their country following the war, who were then welcomed and hosted here in Rome and then helped on their journey to the United States. Therefore, it's since the 1980s that we have felt a deep bond with the Syrian Christianity, a bond made up of respect for a humble people, a people of martyrs. But how can we understand the Syrians without knowing of their martyrdom? And their martyrdom is one they share with the Chaldeans, the Assyrians, and the Catholics. Therefore, we can see that there is a religious memory concerning the martyrs. There's a historic memory. And the historic memory, as far as Seyfo is concerned, as His Holiness was mentioning, has developed very much in recent years, and now with the centennial. But as we know, centennials come and go. We have to remember how we should cultivate a historical memory, since that means telling the painful story of mankind. People are interested in getting to know the stories, the histories of men and women. We cannot forget. Stalin crudely said that the death of a man is a tragedy. The death of millions is a mere statistical figure. We have to tell the story of one, two, or three, up to 1 million men. But even this is connected with the present in the Middle East, almost in the same regions. And currently, it has an impact on Christians, Yazidis, and Muslims. There's also religious memory as far as martyrs are concerned. A model was the one of the early centuries. And as far as the 1900s goes, the century of martyrdom, the churches weren't very able to create a memory. And remembering for a church means accepting memory both in the cult and in teachings. It means accepting the prophecy of the martyrs. Today, our desire is to organize a historical conference with scholars to remember. And as the patriarch said, remembering doesn't mean revenge. A historical memory becomes mature in the passion of a church which has experienced this story. Our desire to research these events is what I would refer to with the Latin word pietas, a memory which embraces those who have fallen. And in introducing this conference, I must ask myself, why did Seyfo happen? Why? Why were defenseless, apolitical, and peaceful Christians exterminated? Why? The Committee of the Young Turks, which took power in Istanbul, wanted a total ethnic cleansing of the Christians. The official explanation for the massacres was that it was an armed response to the revolt and the collaboration of the Armenians with the Russians and their desire to secede from Turkey. It is a disproportionate response, first of all, but that's not what I want to go into. I wonder, how did the Syrians revolt? How did the Chaldeans revolt? How did the Syrian Catholics revolt? Florence de Lobelier will be talking about the Assyrians, which is a unique story. Seyfo didn't happen by chance in a confused East. It was a very thought-out choice. The Young Turks' desire to commit the ethnic cleansing of the Armenians was something based on nationalism. It was the son of the nationalistic culture of the 1800s, which wanted to create nations through assimilation. The Young Turks wanted to assimilate the Kurds because they were Muslims who were faithful to the Caliph. But then they soon realized that the Kurds could not be assimilated. And even for the Kurds, the deportation started, which then continued with Ataturk. And nowadays, some Kurdish representatives recognize the historic mistake made by Kurdish officials at the time when they collaborated in the massacres. Dear friends, the slaughters are a story of barbarity which shouldn't be turned into numbers. They are a dramatic event which needs to be remembered. But these barbaric stories are part of a project, a crazed and rational project. That project is ethnic engineering to remodel Ottoman society and making it entirely Turkish, and thus destroying the mosaic of groups which existed. A citizen of Diyarbakir, whose home can still be visited since it has become a national monument, Ziya Gökalp, a follower of Durkheim's sociology and a follower of European nationalism, was the one who designed racial engineering. As a child, he had grown up next to the Syrians, the Armenians, the Chaldeans in Diyarbakir. And a school in Diyarbakir still bears the name of Gökalp. Perhaps Gökalp had played with Christians as a child, because in Diyarbakir, there is still a wonderful Syrian church, a large Armenian church, and a Chaldean church, although the faithful only are a small number. Born in the eastern provinces, Gökalp wanted to create ethnic homogeneity. He knew who the Syrians were. He knew that they were different from the Armenians. But in one of his poems on the new Turkish world titled The Red Apple, he wrote, he said that it is important to know the East. He said that our people is a garden and we are the gardeners. the trees can't simply find a new youth by inserting new branches. First, we have to cut off the old branches. In fact, their desire was that of cutting off the branches, cleansing. This is engineering, which to him became almost poetry. An Ottoman institution, the Directorate for the Replacing of Refugees and Tribes, under the guidance of Gökalp, who was the first professor of sociology in the University of Istanbul, conducted ethnographic scientific research on the Alevites, the Kurds, the Armenians, the Assyrians, and the Syrians. He wondered who could be assimilated. The Young Turks feared that certain territorial areas, which were ethnically homogeneous, could then lead to separatism. That explains the struggle against the Assyrians in the Hakkari Mountains. I don't understand the struggle against the Syrians in Turbdin, who were a minority vis-a-vis the Kurds. They were a minority. And yet, Turbdin became a region in which the Christians were hunted down. It was a manhunt. We can't understand the military intervention against Ain Warda, where the Syrians fortified the church and were besieged by a huge amount of Ottoman troops. And they were able to resist for 52 days, more than the Armenians in Musa Dagh, as depicted by Franz Werfel's famous novel. And there was also resistance in Ha, a village with a magnificent church. The concentration of Turkish military forces against the village of Azak is inconceivable, a village populated by Syrian Orthodox and Syrian Catholic communities. The empire was at war, and there were larger challenges. And David Gaunt said that there were Ottoman troops supported by the Germans. And that case was illustrated as an Armenian revolt by the Ottomans, which they feared could be connected to the revolt in Sinjar, which Ternan wrote, in which the Yazidis were generously defending the Christians. This resistance were episodes in the Syrian history, which also had its own armed resistance. Although most of the Syrians, as a witness mentions, as lambs to the slaughter. And they show how there was an excess Turkish military concentration. But in the Turkish memory, from the Turkish point of view, the Christian ethnicity had to be erased. And this is something which brings to mind the Nazi German persecution of the Jews, even when Germany was at war. It is a rational and crazed strategy, because the Syrians, again, posed no danger, they posed no threat. The real threat was the war that the British and the French were waging against the Ottoman Empire, not a handful of Syrian Ottoman citizens. Seyfo wasn't an accident. It was the outcome of a terrible plan, that of eliminating the Christians who felt they were Ottoman subjects. It was a desire to clean the earth of minorities which weren't assimilated. And to do this, the people's hate had to be fostered. And how could this hate be fostered if not in the name of Islam? There's another aspect of this barbaric massacre, which is hate towards Christianity. The farmers on the Anatolian plain didn't feel they were Turks, even though they spoke the Turkish language. They felt they were Muslims. And the Turks felt the voice of the Islamic caliph, a caliph. And therefore it became a great jihad against the Jaur, the unfaithful. How would it otherwise be possible to mobilize the masses whose labor and whose complicity the Young Turks needed? Well, through anti-Christian hate. That's how the Christians were attacked. The Catholic Armenians and Catholics in general. And the Sublime Door had declared to the Germans and to the Austro-Hungarian forces that the Catholics would have been untouched by persecution. Therefore, among the people, hate towards the Christians had to be fed. And that's due to another reason, social hate. Often, the minorities, also thanks to the help of the missionaries and their schools, had a higher level of education. Less in the Syrian case, who were more isolated in the Turbdin. And the Russian consul, Nikitin, noted down the hate brought about by the cultural level of the Christians, so much so that in 1913, a commission was sent from Istanbul to help the Muslim schools. And the hate grew due to the impact of the Muslim refugees from the Balkans who settled in Anatolia following the birth of the Christian states. And I wonder, what did the Syrians have to do with the Bulgarians? And yet, in the collective conscience which created, there was a bipartition between Christians and Muslims. The Christian neighbors were seen as part of the same block, the one belonging to the Bulgarians and the Serbs. And it was a real distortion. Social hate and religious hate turned neighbors into enemies, although these people had been working side by side. This is the history of genocide. That's why we have to use the word genocide. And the construction of the threatening figure of the victim, and therefore killing the victim, is seen as a preemptive defense. This was a political and religious construction, although its roots were economic. In Mardin, there hadn't been any slaughters during the Abdullah Hamid era. The Vali of Diyarbakir, Rashid, who was a young Turk and a physician, felt he had to expel the disease from the Turkish body. That disease was the Christians. And Rashid sent to Mardin an MP, a member of parliament, Fazi Prinshizadeh, to inform the local notables on the anti-Christian violence. And Fazi said to the Muslim elite, "Who is blocking you from action? Is it perhaps a fear that you'll have to pay the consequences one day?" But what did they do to those who killed the Christians under Abdul Hamid? Nothing. And now we are stronger. Germany is with us. Let us therefore get rid of these Christians so that we can become the masters in our own home. This is the idea of all of Islam. Masters in our own home. That was the concept. Christians were perceived to be foreigners, collaborators of the French who had intervened in Ottoman affairs, often in the name of protecting the Catholics. And the protection of the minorities was an institution that the Young Turks wanted to abolish. But anti-Christian hate was also fed by religious views. But we should also remember another aspect, which is often ignored. Assets. Seyfo witnessed the pillage of Christian property by the Kurds and the Turks. Properties, monasteries, churches, land, businesses. This pillage brought together the Muslim groups and made them take part in the policy of genocide, making them accomplices. And the pillage suffered by the Christians brought about the fortune of a number of families, which went from the Ottoman world to the Ataturk Republic, the same families. I mentioned the Prinsizade family from Diyarbakir, who were involved in the massacres, various generations. First in the massacres of Abdul Hamid in 1915, and the expulsion of the Christians in the 1920s. And they were also ministers and members of parliament during the Republic. And the pillage against the Christians did not make the Muslims richer, and it made Turkey poorer. In 1926, John Dewey, the famous American philosopher, was invited to Turkey. And he noted, what country is this? It's a miserable country. The economic situation, Dewey wrote, is tragic. Christian businesses are inactive or shut down. To make the economy Turkish meant impoverishing society. Before I conclude, what I want to add is that the events in 1915 and during the First World War was an absurdity. No murder can be explained, but there can be some reasons. And here we're facing absurdity. It was a bloodshed based on ideology. In the Ottoman territories, there were Germans, Austro-Hungarians who witnessed the deportations. This is fully documented, as Yakub knows very well. And the events which happened were so absurd that in September 1915, Pope Benedict XV wrote a message to Sultan Mehmet V, in which two words were repeated: unthinkable and unmentionable events. Let me read the Pope's words. We are reaching the painful message of the suffering of a people, which in the vast Ottoman Empire are subject to unthinkable suffering. We are being told that entire populations of villages and cities are forced to abandon their homes and to move with great suffering to faraway concentration areas, in which, besides moral anguish, they also have to live in misery and torture. Why was why were the authorities at the time so afraid of the Christians? And at the time, the Christians weren't a united front. They were divided. Each community, and these were non-ecumenical times, in which there was no office such as the one headed by Cardinal Casper. Maybe there were less problems, less dreams too. But in any case, at the time, in those non-ecumenical times, each community had its own strategy. And the communities were in conflict with each other. And the Ottoman power was often used by one community against each other. And those who were perpetrating the slaughters played on these divisions. In Midyat, for instance, the Syrians were led to believe that they would have been that only the Catholics and the Protestants would have been attacked because they had links with the foreigners. And the eminent Syrian family, the Safar family, a family of Pashas, thought they were safe. But then the time came for the massacres of the Syrians who defended themselves. In Mardin, the relations between Syrian Orthodoxes and the Catholics weren't very good prior to the war, because a Syrian bishop, Lado, went from the Syrian Orthodox Church to Catholicism. And during the violence, the Syrians weren't very much affected in Mardin, whereas elsewhere they were slaughtered. And I have an explanation as to why that happened. In Mardin, half of the population was Christian, and the Ottoman authorities couldn't wage war on half the population. Again, the communities weren't a united front. They all suffered bitter and diabolical days. This expression, bitter and diabolical days, was written by the Syrian Catholic bishop Tapuni to his patriarch. The Chaldeans, although they were Catholics and therefore officially exempted from deportation, lost three bishops, much of their people, priests and monks. In Sète, the murder of the Chaldean Archbishop Maradai, who was 48 years old, and he had been hidden by a Kurdish aga, but then he was seized, happened before a witness who wrote. And why am I mentioning this? Well, because this bishop was a wise man. He was the author of Nestorian history books, and he had a vast library in which he had very many important historical documents. It was all burnt down in 1915. Because remember, dear friends, the genocide of the people is also accompanied by a cultural genocide. Books, manuscripts, historical monuments, churches, century-old buildings were destroyed. It was a cultural genocide. There were a number of different strategies. The character of the communities was different. The Chaldeans, the Assyrians, who lived in the mountains and who lived along with the Kurds and Hakkari, there were those who negotiated, there were those who paid, like Maradai and Sète. But the money was taken and they were killed anyway. Those who tried to negotiate, such as Tapuni and Mardin, and Tapuni, poor man, had an interesting activity. He would buy back the Christian children who were sold on the market. Tapuni bought back Christian children, or other people, like the Syrian bishop, Mar Felixinos Ablad, in Ain Wardo. Mar Felixinos preached in the castle church of Ain Wardo on the duty to resist, and he invoked the Holy Spirit. He then went up to the roof of the church, where he fasted and prayed for 17 days until he died exhausted, as the others were fighting. But no strategy was successful. I also want to underline before I conclude, and the fact that no strategy was successful shows the determination, the absolute determination of the Ottomans in killing. Yet the genocide brought about a shift in the relations between Christians. And I'll explain with an episode. In 1931, the apostolic delegate, Margotti, with a very long and complicated journey, he traveled by train from Istanbul to Aleppo, and then from Aleppo to Mardin. And he describes how in the Mardin train station he was received by all of the United Catholics, which was something new. And as soon as he arrived in the home of the Chaldean bishop, he also received the visit from a Protestant delegation and the delegation of a number of Syrian bishops. In 1931, the relations had changed. And Margotti writes that the people told him, "You see, Monsignor, I was on the terrace. The Turks came and they cut the throats of my parents." And a woman pointed to a home and said, "That was my home. They killed my children in there." I also want to say that the pain of those who survived must be remembered and honored. And I also want to remember the survivors who lived, forced to convert to Islam. Women, children. French Dominican priest Ritteret described the children's market, which took place in front of the Syrian Catholic Patriarchate building. It was a true market. Unfortunately, a child was worth the same price of a lamb, and children under the age of 2 had no market and were therefore killed. There is no testimony as to how the children experienced all this. And a child described how the Turks would choose the best looking young men and women, and he says, "With my brothers and sisters we would embrace. We did not want to be separated. and we waited for our fate. We were petrified. How is it possible to remain unmoved by so much pain when one believes? Monsignor Balakian posed a question to an Ottoman official. He asked him, "Why are you a Muslim capable of killing so many people?" And Ibi answered, "It's the jihad. It's a holy duty. The other person no longer exists. The child isn't a person. He is a thing." And we have to be honest. Not everybody perpetrated the massacre. This is the crucial mistake in denying these events. Hiding those who did not take part in the massacres. There are a number of Muslims who did not take part. Righteous Muslims. And when we talk about Seyfo, we have to talk about the murderers. But we also must not forget those who were righteous. Nabe Bulidi Musul opposed the massacre. The Muta Sharif in Mardin defended the Christians. And he ran to the German vice consul to denounce those events. Ottoman officials resisted, but the poor people did too, such as Salimo, a Kurdish farmer in Midyat, who was informed of the project to kill the Syrians, and he warned the Abdiyo Syrian family. He warned them, "You have been generous with me, and I want to be generous with you." There were Kurds who hid Christians. And there were also important sheikhs, such as Fatullah Hamidi, a Sufi leader who was a mediator between the Syrians and the Ottomans in Ain Warda. Dear friends, I'm about to conclude. I feel that our historic memory can give us the dramatic and human sense of this story. A terrible story, a terrible history. The bones of these people were buried in the fields of northern Mesopotamia and sometimes they still emerge from the land. And we're convinced that memory should not be buried under ashes. Remembering is a duty we have for all the lives which are stolen from children, adults, and the elderly. Remembering for the Syrian Chaldean, the Syrian Catholic, and the Syrian churches means understanding how we can be loyal to that martyrdom. But it's an issue which affects us all, because that martyrdom is a heritage we all have. Remembering doesn't mean hating. It doesn't mean creating the fruits of hate. And His Holiness talked of reconciliation. Reconciliation stems from the recognition of those who were witnesses to martyrdom. It stems from knowing this part of human history. It's not a matter of repeating numbers. We're all familiar with the figures, even 500,000 victims. But we're talking about thousands of families, thousands of children, thousands of pains, thousands of tears. And I'll conclude with a phrase spoken by an Armenian elderly lady in the Palu region, in Havav. She was a happy child. And one day a terrible day happened. I didn't die, but I was forced to convert to Islam. And she hid her Christianity for decades. And as an old woman, she called her granddaughter and said, "I am not a Muslim. I am Armenian." And she showed her a book she had, a book she didn't know how to read. It was an Armenian Bible. And she said, "This is the book of my God. I don't know how to read it, but it is my book." And she then said, "I hope those days will disappear and never come back. We want to remember, but at the same time we want to pray so that those days may disappear forever and so that they may never come back. This is our hope. And for those of us who believe, this is our prayer. We hope these days never come back."
We wish to thank Professor Riccardi for his words and for his contribution, letting us into the heart of our proceedings. We fully understand from what he said that forgetting or not remembering can be convenient, because in what we have been listening to, there is this feeling of suffering, bitterness, powerlessness. But through Professor Riccardi's words, I think we all felt this encouragement for those who are listening, not just those who are participating in this conference, to have the human courage and the faith so that that massacre is no longer forgotten. Because only through this painful process of memory, of really immersing in so much pain, there is the possibility of thinking that the wish of the conclusion of Professor Riccardi, that all that will no longer happen, is not just a wish and a hope, but it can really turn into reality. Now I'd like to leave the floor to Professor Yosef Yacoub, a well-known scholar who grew up in the Syriac Lebanese world. And for many years, for a long time, he has been living and studying in France, in Lyon, more specifically. And those who know him are also aware he's a specialist on the Assyrian people, the contemporary history of Assyrians. So I'd like to take this opportunity to tell you that shortly, another volume, another book of his will be published on the history of Assyrian Chaldean of the Caucasus. So his voice is well placed in this in our research, because it can provide important testimony and documentation on the Syriac Chaldean Assyrian genocide according to the international sources and documentation. Thank you, Professor, for being here.
First of all, I would like to express my thanks to the community of Sant'Egidio, especially to Professor Riccardi, Andrea Riccardi, and His Holiness, the Patriarch of the Syriac Orthodox Church, Ignatius Ephrem Sagand Karim, for inviting me to take part to this important colloquium and to share with you a moment about the documents and many sources concerning the Syriac genocide occurred in 1915. قديشوتي فاترياركو يونان حسي ميقري بني عميثان سوريوي كنشو بريخو شلوم عليخون مللنو بليشونو انجليسويو علو سيفو دعامو ألفو وتشعمو و 15 after listening to His Holiness and to Andrea Riccardi, I will not insist in my speech on the description of the genocide, because it was very well made. Then in my speech is divided into some main guidance point. I give them to you. The first question, what kind of sources we hold about this genocide? In the second, I will try to demonstrate that the genocide was also an ethnocide and cultural genocide. In the third point, I would like to enter into the documents and to try to extract some point that seemed to me very important to be known, the content of the document. And the fourth point, we are wondering what's the value, the truthfulness of this document. And in the final point, about some political and ethical reflection contained in the many genocide Syriac document. In introduction, I would say that it is important that the atrocities had been committed in 1915 were not only against Armenian, our brother Armenian people, but also against Assyrian, Chaldean, and Syriac. But unfortunately, this mentioned community in the past story didn't pay enough attention about them, as it was said they were, unfortunately, and they were bad known, even they were ignored. However, we have a large set of documents, a very large collection on this genocide. And we can say that today we need not only one PhD about this genocide, but more than 10 PhD, because the number of documents is something amazing in many different languages and deriving from many countries in the world, deriving from missionaries, from consular reports, from ambassadors, from nurses, from doctors, and many of them were witness of this genocide. I would like to give some examples about it. In French language, in British language, in American, in British, I mean in British, the state, the United Kingdom, in British documents, American, Italian too, in Austrian, in Vatican documents, some of them were published very recently by Professor Ruissen, who will speak tomorrow, I think. And I would like to add something very important. We have a large collection of gathered documents on Syriac language and in Arabic language. In Syriac language, His Holiness mentioned Sleiman Hanno. Sleiman Hanno is very important. I will speak about them. Very important. But we have a lot of numbers of documents on Syriac, in classic Syriac, in Marboyo, in Madenhoyo, in Eastern, and Western Syria. I am working about them. I devoted some pages about these documents in my book, in the Assyrian Syriac Chaldean genocide, and it is impressive the precise details given by Abdel Masih Qarabashi, by the book of Mumrid al Seyfo, by Gallo Shabo, and so on. We can take another example, the exodus, the forced exodus undertaken, made from Hakkari to Urmia and Salamis, was described in further details by many Assyrian eyewitnesses and survivors, and I will quote from on them after. If we want to detail this document in French language, for instance, in French, we have many diplomatic reports. We have many diplomatic reports, consular reports, coming from Baghdad, coming from Mosul, coming from Basra. Many documents, written documents, about the situation in Tur Abdin, made by many American consul, right, in Diyarbakir, in Kharput, in Van. It's something huge, something amazing. Unfortunately, I haven't the time, enough of the time, to give them in details. The American too, the ambassador, Henry Morgenthau, which is known about the Armenian genocide. In his memoirs, he mentioned at many occasions the Syriac, Chaldean, and Assyrian genocide. It's an example from others. The British, I would like to focus on them, to focus on one book published in 1916, the British Government Blue Book, which contains more than 600 pages, with many official documents written by consul, by missionaries, and so on. On the more than 600 pages, more than 100 pages are devoted entirely with many precise testimonies about the Assyrian, Syriac, Chaldean genocide, who know it. And when this book, the Blue Book, was translated into French language in Laval in 1916 or 17, we discover that, unfortunately, the pages, the more than 100 pages devoted to this genocide, were not translated. Why? Wasn't it? I discovered this book, why, in French language. How I arrived to this conclusion? Because I began my research about the Assyrian Syriac genocide in 1980. I published my first article about the genocide in 1984. It was published in French language, in an Armenian newspaper in Paris, Gamk, and was immediately translated into Syriac language and into Arabic language by Hoyodo in Södertälje in Sweden. And I have the honor to have discovered the first document about the genocide written by Moran Mor Afrem Barsoum. Mor Afrem Barsoum, he was the vicar of the patriarch Elias III Shaker. He came to London. He came to London, and he came to Paris, calling for the right of his people and denouncing the mass murder against the Syriac, not in Tur Abdin, but not only in Tur Abdin, not only, because he was a very open-minded. I discovered this document in the British archives, in the public record office, in Kew. Kew is in the vicinity of London. And it was a very great pleasure for me when I discovered this document. And since this time, this letter was translated into Arabic, into Syriac, into English, and was spread in many many documents. What we can extract some of the extracts of this document. I distinguish between the theoretical level and the practical level. Theoretical level and practical level. On theoretical level, we discover that this document agree one with other. It's very important. Agree one with other. Between among this agreements, there are one point I would like to insist on it. That the orders were given by Talat Pasha and Enver Pasha. The orders were given on the top of the Ottoman state. And this term of order, we found it in French language, ordre. In Syriac language, Fukdono. In Assyrian language, Pukdana. In Arabic language, Amr. That the decision was not at the local level, that it was something planned, premeditated, systematically, conscience by the top level of the Ottoman the Ottoman authorities. Let me mention some of this document. Gallo Shabo. It ihab fukdono min sultano d'Osmanoye. It ihab fukdono min sultano d'Osmanoye. The order was given by the Ottoman. It ihab fukdono min ho melko din taye. Dnet qtail kul man dmet qri bash motub mshihoyo. In Arabic language too. صدر عن ملك القسطنطين أمر. In the Assyrian document is the same. تخوما وتياري ترون توخن سلطان بقدلي مخرا وتوخن قطلة ودلي بتوا توخن بلوشن بلاشا قشم موخن. I think it is very important, especially for those who doubt on the credibility, on the veracity of the genocide, saying, alleging that not it was something parallel to the Armenian genocide, but was not really a genocide. I mentioned the Syriac, Arabic, Assyrian, but we can mention largely many other documents in French. In French, Andrea Riccardi mentioned the Dominican Fathers, Jacques Rétoré, Jacques Rétoré, Yassin Simon, and Dominique Béret. These three documents, three missionaries who were in Mardin, they were deported from Mosul to Mardin. They have seen everything. And in their book about Mardin, they describe in detail. Yassin Simon wrote in his manuscript, "I can doubt of the sky. Je peux douter du soleil, but I cannot doubt that the Ottoman Empire decided on the top level, on the top, to massacre, to eliminate and to eradicate the Syriac, Chaldean, and Assyrian population." And on practical level, I would like, with your permission, to mention some examples. The main torturers are mentioned the same in the whole document. Rashid Bey, the Wali of Diyarbakir. Javdat Bey, the Wali of Wan. Everywhere in the book, Ishaq Armali, for instance, in his book, The Calamities of Christian, Al-Qusara fi Nakabat al-Nasara, he pointed out on him, Abdel Masih Qarabashi, and so on. Rashid Bey, Javdat Bey, who tortured, butchered the Assyrian population in Urmia Isalamas since January 1915 to May 1915, and after he came back to Van, to Betlis, to Sa'rt, to exterminate the torture are the same in the old books. You know. Many dates. Antomos Yaqub, the martyr, Antimos Yaqub, the martyr of Kerboran, Der Salib, for instance, Ad-Daisher, the bishop, Antimos Yaqub, Monseigneur Ad-Daisher, the bishop Ad-Daisher, many others in Mardin. In conclusion about this point, we can say that the documents about the genocide are reliable. One agree the other. There are no contradictions between them. About now, I come to speak about the truthfulness, the veracity. Are this document, reliable or not? I will reply to this question by this fact. The blue book, before its publication by Viscount James Bryce, who was an MP, a British MP, and he is a great historian, James Bryce. And Arnold Toynbee, who was a young historian at this moment. These documents were collected specially by James Bryce before publishing as official British document, because it is a British official document. Before publishing, he submitted them to some academic experts. So, one professor at Oxford University, one He was the vice chancellor of Sheffield University, and the third was from Boston, who was a lawyer from Boston, a former president of the American Bar Association. And they replies to the question asked by James Bryce that all this document we can be considered as reliable, and they conclude it was a genocide perpetrated against these people. The same James Bryce, it is something ignored, has prefaced the book of Joseph Naim. Joseph Naim was a Chaldean father from Urfa, Ure. He published in French language in Paris by Blue Degay Publishers. He published a book entitled Les Assyro-Chaldeans et les Arméniens massacrés par les Kurdes. The Assyro-Chaldeans and Armenians massacred by the Turks. This book was translated immediately to English language. He was issued in New York during the traveling of Joseph Naim in 1918 in Europe. He met in London James Bryce. James Bryce wrote the introduction of this book, in which he said that there is a truth genocide against massacre, because the term was not invented at this moment, against the Assyrian genocide. And he said that he encouraged Joseph Naim to translate his book for the British, for the American public. I don't know if I can 2 minutes, or I have to...
3 minutes.
Many thanks. About political and ethical reflection drawn from this report, I think this question deserves to be raised, because what we can discover that in this document, especially in the Syriac document, there are many moral and ethical thought reflection about the war, and about the genocide. In the book of Ishaq Armaleh, for instance, who was Syriac Catholic, in his book, there are many important reflections about the war, I give you one example, the co-responsibility of Germany. What Germany, a Christian state, what Austria, a Catholic state, what they are doing with an Ottoman Empire. They didn't understand. They didn't. And then we can find in their book many very important reflections. There are reflections too about the autonomy. Arnold Toynbee, for instance, this important historian, he pled for an autonomy for the Syriac Assyrian Chaldean. He pled for their autonomy in Tur Abdin, for instance. But, and he defended it, he argumented it for an autonomy. We have many reflections about the self-determination of people, because they consider, many of them, in any case, many of them, they consider this population as a nation, as a people. Then they conclude that this people has the right to preserve its identity,
its culture, its Syriac language. And for concluding, just 1 minute, for concluding, I think today this important gathering is an illustration of it, the Syriac genocide, its recognition is underway. It's something very serious. Worldwidely, the question, an international question. About this, I would like to give two examples. The declaration made for the first time in the history of Vatican, by His Holiness, the Pope Francesco. In 12 April, he recognized the Armenian genocide, but not only on. In the same phrase, he continued, he mentioned Syriac Catholic, Syriac Orthodox, Assyrian Chaldean. I think it's an historic document, right? Worldwidely, because this document immediately has the important effect in the world, in Germany and in other places. And the second, I would like to end by what the Syriac Orthodox Church, with His Holiness, is doing about the genocide. My book about the genocide was published in October. I finished writing my book in the end of the end of August, and I learned on 2 August that I conclude by this Holiness, that the Syriac Orthodox Church of Antioch and all Eastern has decided by His Holy Synod held in Damascus in May 13 to commemorate the Syriac genocide with this motto, pour ne pas oublier, for not forgetting. Thank you, Holiness, and thank you very much.
We'd like to thank Professor Yosef Yacoub for having illustrated so well, for having allowed us to understand that it's possible to turn this forgotten massacre into a known massacre. The material is available, and it takes the patience and the passions, not only of the scholars, it takes the passion and the patience of all those who want to make sure that light is finally shed on this tragedy as a way of building the future together. Thank you very much indeed, Professor. And now I'd like to pass the floor to Professor Florence Elobili, who will be discussing something a little different from what we've been hearing so far. The professor has focused on the events in which the Assyrians and the Chaldeans were involved. She focused on the Iranian region in the relationship between the Assyrians and the Chaldeans with the Ottoman Empire, the Russian Empire, from the 19th century to the end of the First World War. And we want to give her the floor to listen to her presentation on the massacres of the Assyrians and their diaspora. The professor will be speaking in French. And I remind the professor that she has 30 minutes time. I'd like to begin by thanking all those who have invited me to take the floor. I could run through my presentation, as a matter of fact, because all the things we've heard so far have been very interesting, and we are running slightly late. I want to talk to you about the Assyrians and the Chaldeans in Iran, Christians who aren't very well known, although they are the direct descendants of the Assyrian Church, the Church of Persia, which was founded in Iran in the 5th century of the Christian era, and therefore they are the descendants or the ancestors of the current Iranian population. Therefore, we want to pay homage to them by describing their history and the tragedies they suffered. Discussing the topic of the genocide of the Assyrian and Chaldean Christians on both sides of the Turkish-Iranian border is complicated. I had prepared some maps, but I can't show them to you on the screen, so simply imagine what I'm about to say. It's difficult to describe the story because beginning in 1915, these massacres were actually the will to exterminate the Chaldeans and the Assyrians and the Assyrians. In the Urmia region where the Assyrians and Chaldeans lived, the first massacres began in January 1915, prior to the month of April, therefore, and they were then perpetrated again in 1918 and in May 1919. Now, in May 1919, the war was over, and the Ottomans were no longer present. And therefore, this led to a decrease in responsibility. And it led to the incrimination of the fact that the Iranians had ignored the massacres. And it also shed light on the cynical policies of the Russians in 1915 and the British in 1918 and 1919. Who created a trap for the Christians. And this led to an increase in violence in the region along the border, along the Iranian border, between 1894 and 1896. And from then on, there was also the murder of the Bishop of Urmia. By a Kurd, Niri, which then traumatized the Iranian populations. And therefore, I think it's safe to say that World War I perpetrated this violence up to its acme. A number of players contributed to the massacre of the Christians and the Assyrians and Chaldeans who lost their lives. They were exiled. They had to flee from their families. And this is the aspect that I'd like to focus on. In the regions on both sides of the border between Turkey and Iran, in eastern Anatolia and in Azerbaijan, 70 to 80,000 Assyrians lived of the Nilakari tribes among the Kurdish tribes, and their patriarch, Mershimun, was slightly distant from these tribes. Although we also have to state that these Assyrian tribes, together with the Kurdish tribes, up to the mid-19th century, the date in which the Kurdish Emirates were eliminated, they had set up two major confederations, the left and right Bazika Federation. And the memory of these confederations was still very much alive during the First World War, an era in which the Kurds had assisted the Assyrians who were part of these confederations. To the west of the Urmia Lake in Iran, 35,000 to 40,000 Christians belonging to the Eastern Church and the Chaldean Church lived along rivers running from the Kurdish mountains. And these populations were stuck between three empires, the Russian, Iranian, and Ottoman empires, in a vast and open area, despite the mountains, at an altitude of 3,000 to 4,000 meters above sea level, in which the inhabitants could circulate freely between Anatolia and the Caucasus. This area suffered due to the weakness of the empire. The Tsar was going through difficult times. And there were, and soon a number of changes on the governmental level would have come about. And therefore, the strategies, the ambitions of the empires met in this area, located to the northeast of Iran, or to the northeast of Turkey. Therefore, in January 1915, there were two alarms, two warnings. The first refers to the Russian preparations along the Turkish-Iranian border. The Russians didn't want to leave, they wanted to stay there, and they were supported by troops formed by Armenian volunteers. And these Christians were poorly disciplined. This was a dramatic factor for the events which followed. And the Kurdish tribes raided the region and were then fought back from these territories. Therefore, there were very heavy clashes during which the Assyrians and Chaldeans filled the streets and declared that they supported the agreement party, and therefore the Assyrian Chaldeans supported their party. And the second warning is represented by the governor of Al-Divan, who asked Mashimun, the Assyrian patriarch, to refrain from participating in the war in the case in which the Ottomans were to enter the war. He asked him to remain neutral because he was familiar. He knew of the bravery of the tribe, the strength of the tribe, and he knew how serious the accusation of selling out to the Russians would have been. These were rumors which circulated and which were pretty widespread at the time. Therefore, I want to divide my presentation into two points. First of all, I want to speak about the events which happened in Urmia and then in Lakari. In 1915, the first major battle took place between the Ottoman forces and the Russian forces, Sarikamish, to the north of the Ivan Lake. It was very cold. The soldiers suffered due to the harsh weather. They weren't equipped to stand the cold, and victory wasn't arriving. Therefore, the decision was taken to go back to the battlefield, to retreat. This is a very important event because on January 2nd, the speaker corrects herself, the Russians abandoned the city and they were followed by a number of Christians while they were fleeing. Some had been warned, 10,000 Armenians and 10,000 Assyrian Chaldeans had been warned. The weather was very cold, they reached the Caucasus, they were welcomed by Armenian and Assyrian Chaldean families who lived there. And they were hired to drill for oil in the Baku region, and therefore they were saved. Those who reached the Caucasus region were saved. Second point, when the army fled from the territory, that's when the Ottoman troops stepped in. They entered Urmia on January 4th, 2 days later, and it's important to remember and underscore the fact that along the journey on the Urmia border, all the villages were devastated and plundered. The populations were slaughtered. They were slaughtered by the Ottoman troops, which leads me to state that this was the actual execution of the plan of the Pasha to exterminate the Christians. It was a plan which was given to the famous CT, as they are referred to, the Ottoman Empire, the Ottoman Army, excuse me. There were, therefore, a number of local inhabitants were killed, and the armies were supported by the Sunni population along the border. And then the army reached Urmia. Iran was neutral. It did not take part in the war. The missionaries weren't expelled. and they therefore welcomed the Christians who were fleeing from the villages. 10,000 Christians, therefore, found shelter in the American mission, whereas the British mission closed its doors. Therefore, there were 10 to 18,000 Christians. The interesting point is that the elite, the city's elite, protected the Christian missionaries from their offshore locations. This is a very important fact. And secondly, the Ottoman army did not intervene. And then in February 1915, the Ottomans went to recover their Chaldean troops in the Tsarist areas and freed 85, 95 perhaps soldiers. Therefore, no mention is made of a slaughter. As you can see, there is somewhat of a discrepancy. And these were people who had been converted to Islam, and Alice de Châtelet is aware of this because they are the ones who resisted the Ottomans when the Ottoman forces had occupied the region in those years. And the Ottomans were very much aware of who had been able to resist and who not. Therefore, these were the ones who were then killed and buried. Yet another thing, the Christians in the central area of the plain found shelter in a village, Adepe, and the Kurds besieging the village were treated by the physician of the Presbyterian mission, who went on site and spent an entire day to treat all the wounded on site. Therefore, this was a context which is very different from the Ottoman Empire. Another observation is that I agree with what Joseph mentioned earlier. An intervention happened in the month of February in a local valley, which brought about a survey of the men who hadn't fled, and taking all the Christians who had fled from Van, and they were all slaughtered in a horrible way. And this event truly was a part of the genocide. Back to Van then. Van was besieged, and only the Russians were able to break the siege in 1915, in May 1915. Therefore, on May 24th, the Russian troops won, and by coming back, they allowed the populations from the Caucasus to go back home. Therefore, it's a very complex situation with the population which had fled to the Caucasus, only a portion of which later went back to Urmia and retook possession of these lands. What happened with the Inakari? Patriarch Mashimun was hesitant. He hesitated again, and he didn't know what to do. Some wanted to continue to be loyal to the Ottomans, whereas others wanted to be on the Russian side. Despite this, in January 1915, the Patriarch saw the preparation and the perpetration of a number of slaughters around Akkadi. And there was an area on the border, Gavara, an area in which Christians were forced to work on the telegraph cables in terrible conditions. So the weather was very cold, and after having transported these cables, they were slaughtered mercilessly. And this constant number of observations and witnesses forced Mashimun to ask for the protection of the Russians. He communicated this to the Vali in Van, who had demanded an answer. And this is written both in the Barda and Surma texts, which were published in 1920, in texts published by Wigram. And therefore, I don't think that this fact can be questioned. Following this, there was a large concentration of Ottoman and Kurdish troops, which besieged the Kadi. And I can't go into the details, although it is something very interesting. The Assyrian tribes in the month of June were able to fight back against the Ottomans. And in the month of June, Mashimun visited the territories, calling for the Russians to help them. Although they were never able to reach the places. In the month of July, there was a new offensive. The Ottomans and the Kurds fought against the Russians in a number of battles. And little by little, the tribes were forced to flee to the mountains at an altitude of 3,000 meters with their flocks, and then reached Bashkale, where the Russians were located. At the end of the summer, between the months of September and October. And once they reached Bashkale, the tribes crossed the border and were then greeted by Vasily Kikhtin, who distributed them in the Masi and Salbak villages. It was a true exodus. They hoped they would have been able to go back to where they had fled from, and it's, but in fact it was the beginning of their exile, and they were never able to go back to Akkadi. They had lost their tribal lifestyle forever, and the patriarch Mashim lost the power he had among the tribes. Therefore, the consequences were huge. In 1916 and 1917, the Russians were on both sides of the border, and no major event happened. Therefore, I'll move to 1918. The most important events refer to Bolshevik Russia leaving the war in 1917. The Russian troops retreated. They retreated back to Russia, to the Soviet Union, and the Ottoman troops wanted to push towards the Caucasus due to the oil in Baku and due to the pan-Turkish idea. And the British, who were traveling north through Mesopotamia, who hoped to occupy Baghdad and Mosul, faced Ottoman resistance. And therefore, in order to solve these problems, the British asked the Christians to form a number of battalions. Therefore, the Chaldean Christians, the Assyrian Christians. Mashimun was hesitant. He didn't agree. He remembered the fact that the Russians hadn't kept their promises, and therefore he was suspicious of the British promises too. He was convinced of the fact that the British wouldn't keep their promises, since no written agreement had been reached. Nevertheless, Grisse from Van was able to convince the Assyrians and the Chaldeans to form battalions. The battalions were formed in July 1918. This angered the Iranians, who opposed the creation of these battalions. And the movements changed, therefore. Therefore, as you can see, the situation was very unclear, with violence breaking out everywhere, which then culminated in February 1918, during a week in which the Muslims and the Christians clashed. And it was the Christians who were able to obtain a temporary victory, and the Iranian notables found shelter in the Christian missions up to the month of July 1918. There was a completely artificial life, and in March, Mashimun was killed in a trap. The Ottoman troops took revenge by murdering the ulema, the religious personalities. They entered the mosques and killed them. And therefore, the situation became unbearable. It's even difficult to describe. On July 8th, 1918, a small British airplane landed in Urmia. And it carried a letter which said, we know we had promised you to send weapons in the month of January. We should help you with weapons and money, but we can't because we cannot bring them to you. So we urge you to come obtain the weapons and money in the south. I would have wanted to show you the map. And it was a real trap. These people went on the journey to obtain these weapons, and nobody could defend Urmia anymore. Therefore, the Ottomans were able to slaughter the entire population, and their survivors, such as the bishop, for instance, described the fact that the Ottomans reached Urmia, and there was an exodus of the Christians towards the south. It was a terrible exodus. It was a very difficult trip. The Iranian revolutionaries were on the field, including the Ottomans. And at the end of the month of August, the Christian survivors reached the city of Ramadan. But another important event is one which happened in 1915 in the same town. The so-called CT were the first troops to enter, and they slaughtered the population. Monsignor Santa, who was the apostolic delegate, was convinced of the fact that nothing was going to happen to him, but he was killed by the Iranian hosting him, and who had collected all of his weapons and money. He was killed by this Iranian. He was killed by his troops, and then the regular army arrived. The army arrived, and the Ottoman commanders stopped the slaughter. Therefore, it's the same process, the same scenario which happened in January 1915, which leads me to believe that the CT troops once again applied the extermination of the Christians conceived by the two pashas. I'll just continue for five more minutes. 350 Christians survived these events in Urmia. And the situation was further complicated by the fact that the Kurds were forced to flee by the Iranians, and the rescue committee, the American Rescue Committee for the Christians, rescued the Kurds. And the Iranian population was angered with the rescuers of the Kurds, and in May 1919, the Iranian population revolted against the Kurds, who were forced to flee, and once again they massacred the Christians who had found shelter on the American mission. 300 Christians were murdered. At that point, the Iranian authority intervened very slowly. Therefore, there was a small number of survivors, yet another major slaughter. And one final point, the Assyrians in Madan, who were sheltered by the British. The British sent them to the Bukba camp near Baghdad, and they were then moved to Mindan, not far from Mosul. And especially the Assyrians from Urm and Akkadi tried to go back to Akkadi and Urmia. The expedition, which happened in 1920, failed, and therefore it was a total disappointment. The interesting thing is that the Assyrians, who had been in the Caucasus ever since 1915, weren't happy with the Soviet Union, which had only just recently been created. Therefore, they asked the Syrians to shelter them. And they were, in fact, able to reach Turkey by boat, and they would form the battalions of the French Legion. Other Assyrians in Mesopotamia, in what would later become Iraq, joined the battalions supporting the British, which also included a number of Kurds, but they revolted against the way they were being treated. And this revolt brought about yet another slaughter in 1932, the Simil massacre, in which the Kurds slaughtered the Assyrian Christians in front of the British, who were passive and did nothing. Following the slaughter, only 35,000 to 40,000 people survived, and they decided to abandon Iraq, which then became an independent state. And Marshimon was deported to Cyprus by the British. He crossed this pass. Unfortunately, I can't show you the map I had prepared. And he goes to the north eastern part of Syria. At that point, the French tried to find a plan for these populations. The SDS was involved. They thought perhaps that they could turn to the British, or perhaps they could be taken to Brazil, on the Gulf Plain in Syria, perhaps. And at the end of the day, they were taken to the Kabur River, where their descendants live to this day. And the interesting thing is that each village has its own tribe. Each village welcomed a different tribe. And therefore, to this day, the Christians live there. And there is this memory of the tribes from Akkadi who fled from Akkadi in 1915 in modern Syria. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you so much, Professor Lobelier, for this painful but intriguing event involving the church. But we understand very well that the church and the events involving tribes are closely linked. We heard about Ivan, a town that is well known, and then Akkari, the Akkari Mountains, dividing eastern Turkey from Iran, and then the Urmia Lake and the Urmia town. We also heard a lot of this about this violent, and as Professor Riccardi was saying, this irrational but insane plan. Violence disseminated, spread in this very insane manner, affecting local realities, Assyrians, Chaldeans, Turks, Kurds, but also the powers affected by this conflict. So the Iranian and Russian empires, the British Empire, and so on and so forth. So it's this escalation of this insane approach affecting the Assyrian community, and the Assyrian community tried to fight against this through, as we heard from Professor. Hello, Bellier. Thank you so much for your reconstruction concerning the Assyrian people and Assyrian church. So in concluding our first day, I would like to leave the floor to His Holiness Refrem for the last words. Thank you.
Thank you very much. First of all, I'm truly very inspired by this great audience we have today. I did not expect this large number of participants, and I thank you all for showing up and showing interest in this subject, which is not, which has not been very popular until very recently. And we are grateful, all of you, for being here and following with us. I'd like to thank also the three speakers, professors, for their papers, which demonstrated their knowledge of the field that they are talking about. And in a way, they complemented each other by shedding light on different aspects, different sides of the issue. Mardin, Turabdin, Urmia, they have truly showed us that they know, not only they know what they're talking about, that they know very minute details about their subject, and we are grateful for sharing with us their knowledge. Thank you so much. I have a few observations also to make. I think we have, the speakers have established, for us at least, for this audience, that what happened in 1915, even before 1895, but also 1915, was nothing less than a genocide, although that term was not known yet, was not coined yet by our Polish friend, but they did indeed show us that what happened amounts to a real genocide. And it's only, I believe it's only a matter of time that everyone will recognize it the way it is as genocide. They also established and proved to us that the Syriac speaking people, Assyrians, Chaldeans, and Syriacs, were not only killed alongside the Armenians, but they were also targeted by orders from Constantinople. And we know that the local perpetrators, including the Kurds, killed our fathers, grandfathers, because we were mainly Christian people there. But higher up in Istanbul, the determination and the intention was to get rid of all non-Turkic elements of that area, specifically the Armenians, the Syriac speaking, and the Greek Pontus and Greeks, other Greeks were there also. So we were targeted. We were not only a byproduct of what happened to the Armenians, but we were also targeted for who we are, non-Turkic and non-Muslims, basically. Another observation, I thank all the speakers for shedding light on so many documents that were not known to many of us, and especially for recently published documents such as the ones from the Vatican archive. And I'm sure we'll find very good information and very good account of what was happening that was preserved for us by both the diplomats as well as the missionaries who were in the area. And we all look forward to the publication of these documents and the study of these documents. I also agree with the speakers, especially with Dr. Yaqub, Joseph Yaqub, that the process of recognition of Seyfo is on its way, that the train is really on the tracks now, and no one can stop it. And I'd like to acknowledge the government of Sweden for being the first government that did recognize Seyfo, recognize the Armenian, but also the Syriac, Assyrian, and Chaldean genocide. And that was over 3 years ago. And then I'd like also to particularly recognize the contribution of His Holiness Pope Francis and his declaration on April 12 at St. Patrick's Basilica that the genocide of Armenians, Syriacs, Chaldeans, Assyrians is the first genocide of the 20th century. That was very, very important. And I believe because of his courage and because of his announcement, many other European countries started recognizing the genocide of the Syriacs, such as, for example, Austria, Holland, and even the German president himself during an ecumenical service, which was attended by Bishop Matthias, he did mention, and he not only mentioned, but he recognized the responsibility, the partial responsibility of Germany for what happened during the massacres. That is very important, and I believe that should be picked up by the scholars and by others to pursue and to further this this cause. And finally, my last observation is that we have learned tonight, this evening, that the Western powers played a role in what happened there. Germans in Turabdin, in Mardin, Diyarbakir, that area, and then British in Urmia. And today, Western powers are still playing a role in the killing, in the uprooting of our people from our homeland in the Middle East, probably unintentionally, but I don't think they care that we are Christians and that we are being killed. They are just helping those who are killing us. They are helping those who are expelling us from our homeland, just as they did 100 years ago. So history is repeating itself. Yes, it is, unfortunately. Once again, I thank you all for being with us this evening, and my many thanks to Sant'Egidio, of course. Thank you. Now,